All right, so next thing on the list is the preload on the car. We're at a straight across sag at the moment. We should be a little bit tilted down with all the added weight from the cage, the spare tire, all that stuff. The car just sits and sags lower than it does normally. And so on the Washington trip, we kept bottoming out. So we need to add a couple inches of preload to this. And then we'll be on our way. Strap around the spare tire because we needed to get a couple more lug nuts for the spare. We didn't think about that when we were at the tire shop. And then do blowout on the clutch, fix the noise on the roof, and then we're out also going to be doing a couple more things with packing stuff in and out for the trip. So before I lift this up in the air, this jack is not pushing up on the unit. We have just about 11 inches of clearance after mounting the brake and blood axes, 32s, which measure a little tall. So definitely not enough clearance there. Front's a little higher, but the back needs to be lifted up. Looking at the blood axe 32s, and we're using a level to give us a gauge. So this needs to be right about there. And we're just at right about 32 inches, just a hair under, with 15 PSI on load of the car. So a lot of guys are scared to do spring compression tools, but if you buy a pack that has two, these guys actually have the half inch socket right in the top of them. And if you do it right, you can align them next to the spring and just do that without any sockets or anything, or you can use a socket to extend above a spring, which is what I was just doing. But then I couldn't get off, and then I realized I could just put them in the top without the sockets, and now I'm just using two ratchets. And so all you have to do is just keep them going at the same time, and then you can see how this one's starting to bow that way to the right. All you have to do is then tighten this one down further, and then so that it's down the middle, and then you just move both at the same time. The whole spring should compress fairly evenly. All right, so I'm on the passenger side. I forgot to tell you guys what the other side looked like, but from the bottom of the upper thread to the bottom of the spring retainer, on this side was 5 7/8. And on the driver's side, I set it to 7. So to this, from that upper thread mount to the bottom of the spring keeper, I measured 7. So I added 1 1/8 preload, which is quite a bit. And what that does is it puts the nylon sleeve just above the bottom of the shock reservoir. So shock body, sorry. Cause you don't really wanna go beyond that. Cause if you start hitting this lip, you'll wear out your shocks, wear out your retainer, and cause lots of more problems than you started off with. But one thing that I noticed on the other side, I already fixed it, but you can see that right here is the bottom of the spring, the very end of the spring. And it sits right next to the opening on the base cup. That bottom of the spring is supposed to be 180 degrees over here. So if you're doing adjustments on your shocks, or if you just are doing maintenance, it's a good idea to check that, because what'll happen is you'll end up tweaking your base cup, and you could possibly compromise the cup, or it could slip into it and cause an uneven load. So bottom of the spring, front of the cup. All right, so just got her off the jack, yanked on her to settle her down a little bit. She's looking a lot better. We went to 7 3/8. So measuring from the bottom of that retainer to the bottom of this retainer where the spring starts is 7 3/8. And you can see from the dirt line, you know, how much we moved. But that's further than OEM wants you to do. It's probably not the best idea. But essentially, it's gonna be a whole lot more stiff back here to support all the added weight up here. We're also going to be moving some of the tools and such to the front floor of the passenger side to help with the weight distribution. And all in all, this should be pretty decent ride this go around. 15 inches of clearance in the back, 17 inches in the front, and that should be way better than the negative squat we had on the Washington Trail. This is the spec Polaris OEM filter on the Polaris RZR Turbo that we drove on the Washington BDR. You can see there's quite a bit of dust in there. I haven't cleaned it out or anything, I just took the lid off, and I'm trying to install a KWT Particle Separator, which needs to take this band off over here, and it's being a pain in the butt. But while I was here, I didn't want to touch and contaminate this until we reviewed the weight of the filter. So unfortunately, I didn't weigh the new filter and this filter, but we can at least get a baseline off of what we have. So here's the filter from the Washington BDR, and it's caked in dust. You can see its dust ring around the inlet and around the casing. So let's do our best to not shake off any of the dust. While we do this, I'm gonna need a stool. There we go. So, we'll gently twist it off of here. Okay. And this is just, you know, using the factory frog skin intake filter, which is over here. So you can see there's no damage to it. It worked pretty well. So this filter, let's go over to the scale and set that down carefully, and for kicks and giggles we'll zero it, and we'll take the dirty filter, making sure not to lose anything. We're at zero. We are at 1 and 9.1 ounces. Taking a fresh brand new filter out of the box, and just for reference, this is part number 124108. So reaching in there, you can see nice and blue, and we're at 1 pound 5.2, so we've gained about, so we are at 5.2, 3.9 ounces of dirt on the Washington BDR. If you were to assume that these both weigh exactly the same, they'll probably be, you know, 0.12 off from each other or whatever. So that filter is going in the RZR on the Idaho BDR, and on the Idaho BDR we are including this KWT particle separator. The install instructions have you drilling a hole through that plastic to get through this hole here, and then it ducts down to the airbox. I'm going to just go without the plastic and not cut it for now, in case our plans change. Hopefully we can avoid this situation. So I'll wipe this all clean, and the Idaho trip will have a fresh filter, a clean box, and we'll be able to measure how heavy it gets with dust particulate when we get back from that trip.
Earlier this week, talking over that fan, like I had no voice left.
Right, yeah. It's a pretty loud fan.
Was that kind of, or do you have one of those voices that just cuts through everything?
Well, if I talk like this, through my nose.
Podcast voice.
1942 radio. So we've been trying to pull this darn air hose out from the air intake that goes to the air box back there. And stuck between the firewall and the hose was this hose clamp. It was not facing outwards for you to grab it, so they must have done it before they put the air box system in. But having the right tool saves the day. So this little gyroscopic ratchet was able to fit at a weird angle with a weird angle at the angle of the dangle and was able to get it done. So get yourself one, you'll end up using it at some point. All right, so that's our air box. We just wiped it out and we just finished installing the KWT system. There's the ducting going through up through the plastics and then up to the bottom of the KWT. You can see it's mounted right over where the stock intake is, but it's facing forward, and there's an air dam on this Razorback off-road cage to push air down into the bed. So not only are we getting natural suction from the intake, but we're also going to be getting fresh air from above. And I just wiped out the air box. There's the clean air box. And here is the brand new Polaris filter. Let's take it out and give it a way down here. So we're over here next to our old filter. And then we'll turn this on and then we'll put the new filter on. 1 pound, 5.1 ounces. So that's going now directly into the machine. Nice and snug, just like that. And then that's the filter we're gonna run for Idaho and see how much it gains from using a prefilter. See how much dust it gets. If it's anything like Washington, it should have about 5 ounces of dust in it. If it does better, should be less. But we are also going on a trip that's twice as long with twice as many cars, so we'll see. I would hope that it comes in less because of the pre-filter. So we'll keep an eye on the tray, keep it clean throughout the trip, and then we will check in on this filter later. This is another good example of why you should be checking your clutches. I was cleaning out the primary, blowing it out with some compressed air, and noticed that I was getting rubbing on the secondary from the casing. And seeing that the belt is sitting down low instead of up at the top. And the reason is that the snap ring keeps popping out, which means that snap ring is bad and we need to replace it because the bell is not staying shut and it's allowing the housing, the sheave, to come too far out. So we're losing performance and we're creating a safety issue, and we're gonna get that fixed. This is a Rotopax mount system, similar to the actual Rotopax mount. It's a long rectangle piece that the Rotopax slides over, and then you tighten this piece down over top of it, and it always seems to come loose, in my opinion. Never seemed to be really happy with the solution. But Tech 208, you order the kit with your roll bar size. This is a 1 3/4 bar. With our Razorback Offroad, it's a 1.5, so we didn't have the appropriate size clamps at the time. But the kits can be ordered however you need them, and so we're going to order some 1.5 inch clamps here. But these are just a 4 mil, and they bolt onto recessed pockets on the base plate. And this base plate has 4 recessed pockets for 2 clamps, and then you can notice that it has 5 points of adjustment at 10 degree increments. So once you get your base plate mounted to, or your mounting solution mounted to the base plate via the 2 included 1/4 inch Allen bolts, you then simply just screw on your face plate, simple and easy. And then once it's on the actual unit, it's just a matter of tightening it down. And you can see that there's grooves CNC'd into the plate to allow the Rotopax nipples to create force on this, and then that creates your friction. And so we're looking forward to putting this on the car. It's really easy, real simple, and you know, fiddling with these types of things and trying to get these lined up correctly and all that doesn't always work out. So having just a simple spin solution works really great and will tie in really great on our Razorback Offroad cage and their solution. So if you're looking for additional Rotopax mounting, you need angle adjustment because you have some sort of custom cage angle or something like that, check Tech 208 out. They have a lot of really premium billet accessories like this, including our fire extinguisher mounts and other various things that you might need. And they're all made in Idaho, USA. They're all billet aluminum, and they have great customer service, and they'll help you out. So check them out, Tech 208 on social and on .com.